For 7 years, Don Meredith was the colorful quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys. The 7 years produced the sunshine and shadows of victory and defeat, which are the growing pains of champions.
High left, fire right, drag left. Ready?
Oh, hunt, hunt!
During the Meredith years, the Cowboys emerged from the shadows and became consistent winners.
It was really a screwed up looking thing. I didn't even know what to, yeah, I think they did. I think they missed it because I didn't want the audible. All right, fire slant 34. Zone two, ready? Blast left.
Hunt, hunt!
Don Meredith left the Cotton Bowl for the last time a winner and left the Dallas Cowboys to fill the most important position in football. 1969 would be a rebuilding year, and the Cowboys would be a team in transition. The new general of the Cowboys was Craig Morton. Morton had patiently waited 4 years for his turn to come, and now it had arrived. The apprentice became the master craftsman. The preseason saw a complete renaissance of the Cowboy backfield. Besides Morton, there was Walt Garrison, who had replaced the retired Don Perkins, and rookie Calvin Hill, full of promise and destined for stardom. While Morton was a quarterback with experience, Roger Staubach was not. An injury to Morton forced the Cowboys to start Staubach, known as much for his running as his passing, in their first regular season game against the St. Louis Cardinals. In game one, the Cowboys relied on an old strength in the time-tested Dallas defense and demonstrated a new one in versatile rookie setback Calvin Hill. But the real difference was Roger Staubach, whose poise and passing turned the game into a rout. Staubach rarely strayed from the pocket as he found and shot holes through the Cardinals' secondary. Dallas walked off with their first victory, 24-3. Though it was Roger Staubach's last start, it was not the last time he exhibited his varied skills. In his first year, Staubach showed professional precision as a passer. He was a runner, not a scrambler, who escaped danger in bold bursts of motion. In Staubach, Dallas found a valuable reserve for Craig Morton. The Cowboys went into their second game with Morton back at quarterback. Morton rarely passed against New Orleans, but contented himself with handing off to Calvin Hill, who scored two touchdowns as Dallas triumphed 21-17. Victory number three was an easy one. For the first time, Dallas displayed its passing might as a healthy Craig Morton bombed the Philadelphia Eagles with three touchdown passes, and the Cowboys won 38-7. The next week in Atlanta, the Falcons separated Craig Morton's shoulder, but Dallas collected a bruising 24-17 win. On the fifth Sunday, Philadelphia came to Dallas. Once again, the Cowboys destroyed the Eagles through the air. After a 4 weeks absence, Bob Hayes returned to the lineup, and the rebuilt Dallas offense was finally intact and fully explosive. 7 Cowboy touchdowns buried the Eagles 49-14. Sunshine turned to starshine in the Cotton Bowl as Dallas faced Fran Tarkenton and the New York Giants. 10 times the massive intimidators of the front line collapsed Tarkenton and held the Giants' offense to a mere 3 points. Game's end, the battered and beaten Tarkenton was fittingly drowned in his own end zone by the Dallas defense for a safety. Through 6 weeks, the defense remained unflinching, and the Dallas Cowboys stood undefeated. The Dallas defense was a perfect blend of savagery and swiftness. Its personality and character was derived from the four men in the pit. The four were ends George Andre and Larry Cole, and tackles Bob Lilly and Jethro Pugh. Eight-year veteran George Andre still attacked quarterbacks with youthful enthusiasm, while young Larry Cole stalked and struck like an old pro. From the inside came the collective might and muscle of tackles Bob Lilly and Jethro Pugh. When Pugh was unable to play, he was replaced by Ron East, number 77, and the defense didn't miss a beat. Backing up the front four were three veteran linebackers. Number 52, Dave Edwards, patrolled one side, while All-Pro Chuck Howley, number 54, roamed from sideline to sideline on search and destroy missions. In the middle was Leroy Jordan, the robust leader of the Cowboy defense. Jordan relished meeting a runner or receiver man-to-man and then assaulting them with serpent swiftness. Behind the linebackers was the secondary. Their job is the toughest in pro football. Defensive backs must fuse the flowing grace of a receiver with the toughness of a middle linebacker. It is a position of persuasion and constant contact. In 1969, three veterans anchored the deep defense. Safety Mike Gechter played most of the season injured, but still was the Cowboys' second leading thief. Cornerback Cornell Green was the Cowboys' best one-on-one defender, while All-Pro Mel Renfro played every position and intercepted more passes with more flair than anyone else in the NFL. While the Dallas defense was individually brilliant, it was as a unit that they excelled. There was no team tougher to run against in all football. They swarmed and smothered and crowded and crushed and came in waves and packs of tacklers. Only 3 times did an opponent cross their goal line by rushing the football. the defense was tough on runners, they were tougher on quarterbacks. The Cowboys tackled quarterbacks more times for more yards lost than any other team in pro football. So, through six games, the refurbished Cowboys looked unbeatable. But in the seventh, their bubble of invincibility was rudely burst by the Cleveland Browns. Browns quarterback Bill Nelson riddled the Cowboys' secondary with quick strikes to Paul Warfield and exposed a weakness in the Dallas pass defense. Cleveland touchdowns came in bunches, and Dallas lost 42-10. Dallas rebounded from their first defeat by trouncing New Orleans. Craig Morton threw for two touchdowns, and Calvin Hill rushed for almost 100 yards in the second half alone. By now, it was apparent to all of pro football that Hill was an extraordinary rookie. Cowboys' 33-17 win was the first of two impressive victories. In Washington, Hill was responsible for victory number 8 as he rammed and bucked for 150 yards, and Dallas won 41-28. Washington, Tom Landry's Cowboys traveled to the West Coast to meet the Sunshine Supermen of the Los Angeles Rams. Without Calvin Hill, who was injured, Dallas was unable to pry apart the Rams' fearsome foursome. Because both teams were division leaders, the game had added luster. On offense, the Rams scored with startling suddenness, while Dallas' touchdowns were the aftermath of deliberate, painstaking drives. While the Cowboys searched for the elusive magic of victory, the Rams stole the scoreboard and won 24-23. After the disheartening loss to Los Angeles, Dallas played uninspired football for the next 2 weeks. They managed a tie with the San Francisco 49ers, and then in Pittsburgh, they scrambled past the Steelers 10-7. With two games left in the regular season, Dallas looked tired and stripped of their vaunted power. Through 12 grueling, strength-sapping weeks, one of the most consistent elements of the Cowboys was the offensive line, led by center Malcolm Walker, guards John Nyland and John Wilbur, tackles Tony Lisio and Ralph Neely. The Dallas line helped Craig Morton launch pro football's most devastating offense. In his first year as a starting quarterback, Morton generated a reconstructed attack that gained more yards than any team in pro football. With a flick of his wrist, Morton powered his passes through the narrowest seams in the secondary. To a quarterback, courage is as much a part of the game as throwing touchdown passes. During the season, Morton proved that his heart was as strong as his arm. Morton played much of 1969 crippled, but he endured the beatings, withstood the punishment, and came back throwing. While the Cowboys had many tools of victory, it was at receiver that they were most secure. Dallas had interchangeable tight ends in veterans Pettus Norman and Mike Ditka. When Bob Hayes was injured, his replacement, Dennis Holman, averaged 20 yards every time he touched a football. But only Bob Hayes can turn those 20 yards into 100 yards. Although he missed the season's first four games, Hayes still finished with over 700 yards in receptions. Even if pro football was a game of two-hand touch, it would be hard to lay a glove on Bob Hayes. While Bob Hayes eluded capture with fluid bursts of speed, Lance Rensel shadow-boxed with a defender until he escaped for that one fleeting moment of freedom. Rensel's uncanny ability to squirm free when it counted was documented by the fact that one out of every four of his receptions was worth 6 points. In 1969, Lance Rensel caught 12 touchdown passes. To complement their long strike capability over ground, the Cowboys gained more yards on the ground than any other team in pro football. Setback Dan Reeves was the most dangerous Cowboy runner inside the 10-yard line. While Reeves was a spot performer, Walt Garrison was not. It is hard to replace a man like Don Perkins, who gained over 6,000 yards for Dallas. But Garrison did. Garrison's billy goat butt and buck style of running accounted for over 800 yards rushing. Then there was the man from Yale, who ran from the cloistered walls of the Ivy League into the pros without losing a stride. Unheralded, but unstoppable, Calvin Hill became the most feared power-speed combination to hit the pros since Jimmy Brown. In a game of specialists, versatile Calvin Hill was a throwback to earlier eras because he ran, caught and passed with equal ease. Whether the Cowboys needed 5 yards or 55 yards, it made little difference to Calvin Hill. Four players were drafted ahead of Hill, but he was football's rookie of the year. Although he ran brilliantly outside at 6'4 and 224 pounds, Hill was made to run over people, and he did. But he didn't just run over tacklers. He jumped over and at them with the zest and style of a Ty Cobb in football cleats. With Hill and their offense healthy again, the Dallas Cowboys met the Baltimore Colts in the 13th week. The defense limited Baltimore to 10 points and forced the old master, Johnny Unitas, into a day of errors. While Unitas consistently overthrew his receivers, Craig Morton coolly split the Colts' zone defense, short and deep. The 27-10 victory was the Cowboys' 10th of the year. Number 11 came against the Washington Redskins in the season's last game. Gearing for next week's Eastern Division playoff against Cleveland, the Doomsday defense checks Sonny Jurgensen and the Redskin offense without a touchdown. The rebuilt Dallas offense scored easily when it had to, and the Cowboys conquered Washington 20-10. It was 7 days to Sunday, a day when the Cowboys would know their renaissance was not yet complete. For the Cowboys, the playoff was a nightmarish instant replay of the first Browns game. Bill Nelson and Paul Warfield ground out first down after first down as they strip bare the Cowboys' secondary. For the second straight year, Tom Landry watched Cleveland defeat his Cowboys for the Eastern Championship. For the Cowboy players, the 1969 season ended 1 week too early. Nothing can erase the disappointment of such a loss, except the knowledge that in a year of transition, Dallas still won a championship.